Greetings and welcome to the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association's Patients Come First podcast. Joining us on this episode are Mark Whiting, the program manager for the Military Medics and Corpsmen Program, MMAC, at the Virginia Department of Veteran Services, and Julie Selvey, the director of nursing and education for Bon Secours Virginia Medical Group. Today we're going to chat about the innovative MMAC program that helps military veterans with medical or healthcare training transition into private sector clinical jobs in places like hospitals. But first, let's welcome Mark and Julie to the program. Thanks for being with us today, folks.
Thank you for having me.
Glad to be here, Julian. Thank you.
And we're glad to have you both as well. As I mentioned, the MMAC program, that's Military Medics and Corpsmen Program, is a first-of-its-kind initiative that was established as a pilot program here in the Commonwealth in 2016 as a result of legislation sponsored by Delegate Chris Stolle, who is a Virginia Beach physician and, shameless plug alert, a previous guest on an episode of the Patients Come First podcast, and Senator George Barker of Fairfax, who is also a strong advocate for healthcare in the Virginia General Assembly. And then last year, in 2018, the program was permanently established in state law with updated supervisory standards. Mark, if you would, please explain how the MMAC program functions to recruit and help place military veterans in civilian healthcare professional work settings by bridging a gap that had been an impediment to employment for some veterans leaving military service.
Well, yeah, thanks again, Julian. Glad to be on your show. What the MMAC program really is a pathway. We offer a pathways to careers. We offer pathways to credentialing. And we also offer pathways to continued caring. You know, as you know, healthcare in many cases is a calling. And to have military personnel who have chosen healthcare as part of their military career continue in that area is special to us. We often hear of from applicants to our program saying, you know, if this had only been around when I was getting out, I would have stayed in healthcare instead of going into another field, because they had that caring aspect. So essentially, it's a pathway, and we do three things at our program. We recruit military trained personnel, especially the medics, Army medics, combat medics, the Navy corpsmen, and the Air Force medical technicians. So we recruit them from a worldwide pool of veterans and transitioning service members who have decided they are going to be leaving the military and entering the civilian world. So we recruit through a variety of ways. I can talk about a little bit later if you'd like. And then once they've applied to our program, we review that candidate. And we look at their background, a very detailed snapshot of their clinical experience. And we classify them in basically three pathways. We have our Military Medics and Corpsmen Program qualified pathway. These are specifically the individuals that fall under our Code of Virginia purview to allow those individuals to continue to practice the clinical skills, the hands-on clinical skills that they learned and administered in the military in the private sector, in the civilian healthcare field, while they're gaining the required credentials. And that's what really sets us apart from a lot of the other military-related employment programs. We're the only state in the country currently that allows these individuals to continue to practice those skills, and it helps them keep their skills sharp. We've kind of flipped that credentials first, employment second model on its head, and so it allows them to keep their skills sharp. It helps them get into employment and support their families, themselves, and they're really adding to that healthcare industry the value that a veteran brings above and beyond those clinical skills. They bring punctuality, teamwork, leadership, attention to detail, all those things, those soft skills, if you will, that are really important in any workplace and especially important in healthcare. So we have our MMAC qualified candidates. Then we have what we call No Veteran Left Behind. That's the medically trained former service member who may be have experience in a physical therapy role or a lab technician, or even the many other skills that could be applied to the civilian healthcare workforce. Those and the non-clinical skills. We tell people often that hospitals are like military installations. They need engineering personnel. They need HR personnel, IT, safety, all those type of things that, and they're needed in the healthcare field. So we have that pathway. And then we have our third pathway, which is our leadership pathway. These are individuals that may have run programs or clinical practices or clinics in the military and may have advanced degrees and experience and could be applied in the civilian setting in a leadership role or management track type position. So we offer those three, and we refer those to employers like our great champions and colleagues over at Bon Secours Mercy Health.
Well, that's a great explanation, Mark, and I appreciate you sharing that overview of the program. You mentioned Bon Secours is a participant in the program. There are a number of hospitals and health systems in the Commonwealth that have participated. Bon Secours, as we mentioned, Carilion in Roanoke, Centra Health, which is in Lynchburg area, Chesapeake Regional Healthcare in Hampton Roads, HCA Virginia, which has hospitals throughout the Commonwealth, Anova Health System in Northern Virginia, Navant Health, UVA Health System, Riverside Health System, which is down on the peninsula in Hampton Roads area, and Sentara Healthcare, also in Hampton Roads and elsewhere. And so I appreciate you mentioning the role that hospitals play here. And to get that sort of firsthand perspective, Julie, I wonder if you could sort of speak about, Mark has explained how the program works sort of from a functional perspective to help these military veterans transition. I wonder if you could explain some more about sort of the practical side of it as someone who has been on the other end sort of as a participant in bringing some of these folks into a healthcare organization like Bon Secours.
Yes, absolutely. I would say, first of all, it takes a really good partnership with DVS and the health system to establish what the goals and the objectives are for the healthcare system, in which the Director of Human Resources, who was the director back in 2016, Paul Janod and myself and another educator, created what we wanted for Bon Secours Medical Group and how would the MMAC candidates fit into the roles for our health system. And I think that's very important in just making sure that we all know what the needs are from DVS's standpoint and identifying the appropriate candidates and identifying the appropriate clinical candidates to fill in the areas that we were looking for. And with that being said, was that the medical group, which is nothing but clinical practices, provider practices, would be the best place for our MMACs to work as their kind of entry-level position with this program being a pilot program. And what we did is we took the memo of agreement and created our scope of practice for Bon Secours, created a job description that would meet the needs for what they were going to do in the clinics and also optimize their clinical skills that they have experienced over the years in their service. Once that was established and code positions and job descriptions were created, we worked closely with DVS in the process for hiring and onboarding the MMACs. And, I've been the director for this program for almost 2 years, and Bon Secours has been the leading health system in bringing in the MMACs, in which we've hired them as clinical care technicians. And for comparison, for those who don't understand what MMACs have done in the service, we've been utilizing them in the capacity of an LPN, in which their scope of practice is fairly identical to what an LPN can do in the state of Virginia.
And could you just give some examples of some of the things that a clinical technician or the roles or duties comparable to an LPN would be?
Yes, absolutely. CCT can accept orders and receive orders from a provider and document in the EMR, just like a nurse could. And they can also administer injections and medications per order by a provider. They work under the scope of practice of a provider, but it is not where it has to be a direct line of supervision. It's more of like that on-site supervision. And it really expands their scope of practice because they can do all the clinical skills that an LPN performs, from blood work to educating patients to small office procedures.
Well, thank you for that explanation. That's great information. Mark, I want to transition back to you. Julie mentioned that Bon Secours has been, I believe, the leader in bringing on MMAC program participants among hospitals and health systems in Virginia. And I guess overall, about 115 veterans have been hired to this program. If you could, can you discuss a little bit more about sort of the role that Bon Secours has played in terms of taking on a lot of these folks, and then just overall what the success of the program has been?
Well, gladly, Julian. And I'm happy to say, since we last talked, when we're up to 123 hires in healthcare so far.
That's great news.
Since we spoke. So, yeah. I honestly can't say enough good about Bon Secours. They were a partner of ours and has been a champion of ours even before the program was officially launched, because they actually brought some of their public affairs and government relations people to the table as the legislation, the enabling legislation, was working its way through our General Assembly. So they, from, you know, essentially day one, they've been a partner and a champion. And they did our first female hire early in the program, hired into the program. They have so far to date the most hires of all of our partners through our program. So they've been there. And another thing that I've just found so tremendous about our relationship is, when other systems are trying to understand the program from that direct healthcare provider's perspective, or if they had questions, Julie, her team, Paul Janod have been just outstanding to work with, because, you know, as you know, the healthcare industry is highly competitive. So in a sense, they were helping others that could be competitors in the healthcare space to launch this program. Because the ultimate value is that veteran gets hired in healthcare and are now supporting themselves and their family. So I think that in this highly competitive day and age and market, that to me speaks volume of the dedication and focus that they have to serve veterans. And we can't thank them enough. And Julie and Paul have been on speed dial for my entire team. Just to run ideas by, and we have such a phenomenal line of communication that it works. They have taken this program to where every person involved with it in the development and the operation, they've taken this program to the heights where we wanted it to go. So, I just can't thank them enough. They've been just phenomenal. And I wanted to touch a minute and your very good question to Julie about kind of the scope of practice of our applicants. We have a defined, what we call our general scope of practice. These are 39 very specific skills and procedures that have been authorized through our legislation for our candidates to administer or deliver in that healthcare setting. They apply when we have that signed, a signed memo of agreement. And what we do, we take the approach with our healthcare partners of, you tell us what skills you are comfortable with in your healthcare system through that scope of practice by identifying, hey, we're comfortable with all of them, or, for example, endotracheal intubation is one of the skills that's permitted by law. But if they're not comfortable with our individuals and our candidates applying that skill, they don't essentially check that box. So they can go down a menu, if you will, and approve individual or collective skills. So, because that's been kind of a mantra of ours, You tell us how you want this program to work, and we will model our processes as well as the candidates that we send you to meet those specific needs for your specific healthcare system. And I think that's helped us be successful.
Well, Mark, I really appreciate you sharing that perspective and confirming what we already know, that Bon Secours has been and continues to be a leader in this space, both in the provision of healthcare and a service leader in terms of its community-minded mission. Very quickly, Mark, I wonder, we talked earlier about the fact that this is an innovative and first-of-its-kind program here in the Commonwealth. If you could just quickly share, have other states at this point looked at this model and looked to implement or replicate what is happening here in Virginia? Because it sounds like a real success story.
Yes, Julian. Other states have been looking to our program and looking to implement. I would say at this point about a half a dozen states around the country are. The one state that has made, I guess, the greatest progress is Louisiana. They have passed legislation. They modeled their legislation after ours to implement a program in Louisiana through their, you know, a very similar agency. They are in the process of ramping that up. Maine has done, they're very close and have done some very similar programming, not identical to ours, but we have certainly been in collaboration with them. Wisconsin is another state, Texas. So yes, to answer your question is other states are looking at this and, you know, and the reaction that we get is, wow, this is kind of a no-brainer. Why haven't we done this before? So we're glad to lead the effort, and we offer every possible assistance we can, from our marketing materials to our legislative strategies, our scope of practice, and things like that. So yeah, as the word is spreading about this, it's certainly generating more interest.
Well, it's good to hear that Virginia has been a trendsetter in this regard, certainly as it relates to helping out men and women who have served the country. Wanted to give people a little bit more information about the program and where they can find more information. If you are a veteran yourself and have healthcare training or relevant experience and interested in transitioning into a healthcare role in the civilian sector, you should go online to the Virginia Department of Veterans Services. That website is www.dvs.virginia.gov. Again, that's www.dvs.virginia.gov. And at the top of the page, you're going to want to click on the Education and Employment tab. I appreciate both of you being with us today on the program. And before we let you go, we're going to close with a lighthearted question that we ask our guests. It's one that we borrow from a popular BBC program, and it's this. If you were stranded on a deserted island, what one book and one album would you take with you? And we will spot you a copy of the religious text of your choice. So other than the religious text of your choice, Bible or otherwise, what one book and one album would you take with you to keep yourself company if you were all alone on an island? Julie, I'll start with you.
Oh, you put me right on the spot. But I think I would definitely enjoy to read the book To Err Is Human. I think there's a lot of lessons to be learned, and from a human factory perspective. And then the album I would like to probably keep would be my Journey album.
Okay. Which Journey album? There's a lot in that canon.
All of them. Actually, if I could have all of them, that would be great.
Okay. And Mark, what about you?
Well, Julian, I would probably want to pass the time. So I've never read War and Peace. So I think that would help occupy my time on the deserted island. And going with the island theme, my favorite album of all time is Bob Marley, Legend.
Don't worry about a thing.
So it would would put me in that tropical mood, and plus it's an outstanding, absolutely outstanding album.
Sounds like perfect island listening music. Well, listen, thanks again to both of you for being on the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association's Patients Come First podcast to talk about Virginia's innovative military medics and corpsmen program. Again, if you would like more information about that program, we encourage you to go online. There are a wealth of resources, and that site again is www.dvs.virginia.gov. Thanks. Well, that's going to do it for this episode of the Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association's Patients Come First podcast. You can listen to this episode and previous episodes of the podcast through SoundCloud, Blueberry, or online at www.vhha.com. You can also send us questions, comments, feedback, or suggestions about future podcast episode guests using the email account pcfpodcast@vhha.com. Again, that address is pcfpodcast@vhha.com. We also encourage you to connect with us on social media, including Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram. You can contact us through Twitter using the hashtag PatientsComeFirst, and our Twitter account is @VirginiaHHA. Thank you.